Thank you very much, Mark, for the introduction and also for the perfect organization. So we are online, okay? So I'm far off of you. So I hope that everything will go smoothly. So let me tell you that before starting, I put some links on the chat about my notes. So what I present here is I will say a short version of a longer text, okay, with references and so on, okay, which is the first thing. So if you want still to come back to this Beamer file, it is public also. And if you like exercise, there is one. Okay. So there is, I will put the links after in a proper way on my home page. For example, I don't know, maybe it will, there will be on the site of the summer school, okay? Ah, okay, so repost the link. Okay.
Philip, maybe a little bit of organization. I'll try and field most of the comments from the chats. And if
okay,
there's something
okay.
that I think you want,
yeah, yes.
I'll interrupt you.
Thank you. So please interrupt me. And of course, I cannot be concentrated on everything, so I cannot look at the chat. Okay. Okay. So let me start with the screen. Okay. So this is not the real place. Okay. So it's a good try. Okay. And so before to talk about the Sarah Swan's correspondence, well, I would like to do a brief introduction about the topic. So it's just to test my material. So what we do is as you know, this is algebraic geometry. So you see my writing and you understand what the reason why I make notes. And what we do today and other days is to take topics coming from differential geometry. Okay? And so there one topic is known for a long time. This is vector bundle. So in algebraic geometry, so we can and we see that today how to make them in a nice way in algebraic geometry. So this is before the Second World War. But what is more interesting and today, this is notion of principal G bundle or principal homogeneous spaces, and which. And so this thing was put in the way in algebraic geometry by Jean-Pierre Serre and Alexander Grothendieck. So there is a date which is 1958, the official birth. But actually, if you go back before, you will see there is an unpublished memory. Memory by Grothendieck. So it is on the note, okay? When he was postdoc I call it the Kansas paper, okay? In Kansas University, which is kind of pre-theory. So it's a Grothendieck way to see about principal G bundles in differential geometry and in analytic geometry. Okay, and many things actually are already in that paper. Okay, so the material I'm talking about today is in many places. Okay, so there are several references. So for example, you have the book by Max Knuth, which is called Quadratic and Hermitian Forms. Over rings, you have the famous book by De Masure and Grothendieck. No, sorry, De Masure and Gabriel. Okay, which is called, which is in French. So we have a short version in English. Okay, so this is not recent, but this book is still yes, the best one, I think. Okay, so group algebraic. And you have also, of course, other reference. So the reason why I'm talking about those reference is they is because they're exactly in the setting I working today. Okay, so today I work over rings, or if you prefer, over affine schemes. Okay, so I will not do the theory of general scheme to simplify. So for people aware of the general theory, it's quite easy to generalize. Okay, so this is because most of the definition of the work is of local nature. Okay, and for people knowing only about rings, and even about rings which are algebras for some fields, okay, they can attend the lecture. Okay, and so let me start with the beginning. So the beginning is with the vector bundles. It is called the Swan-Serre correspondence. Okay, so what is this correspondence? It's the correspondence between projective finite modules of finite rank, or projective modules of finite rank, and vector bundles. Okay, and this correspondence was known in the differential geometry setting. Okay, so on paracompact topological spaces. Okay, so there is a beautiful paper by Robert Swan. So this is this reference 37. Okay, and I will recall it explicitly because this is really the first stone of the construction in the setting of affine scheme. And what I follow, it's more or less the book of Gerz-Vedon, okay, which is an excellent book, by the way. Okay, so sorry. I should find a. Ah, okay. So this is better. Okay. So what are vector group schemes? So before talking about vector groups, so we are given a ring, so a ring of algebraic geometry, so namely commutative unital, and we take an R module, and with this R module, we can attach this symmetric algebra. Okay. And we can take the spectrum of this symmetric algebra. Okay, so this is an affine scheme over R. And in terms of functors, so what I call an R functor, this is if I take a R algebra S, I can consider the home of M to S, which is the same thing there. Okay, bon, so this is just the fact it represents the R functor, this is the universal property of the symmetric algebra. Of course, if you take M to be R, okay, what you find is just the affine line. Okay. So this is very classical. Bon, so this is this construction. And bon, so it's called the vector group scheme attached to M. I realize I sliced too much, but it's too late to change. And the important thing, if you are you work in the Grothendieck setting, this is that it commutes, that construction commutes with arbitrary space change of rings. Okay, so there is, what the nice thing is that we can really like that see modules like schemes and conversely. So in a clean way. This is to say that the functor which associates to a module M, the vector group M, is an anti-equivalence of categories between the category of R module and that of vector group schemes. Okay, so be careful, this is anti-equivalence. It permutes the sense of the arrows. And the inverse, an inverse vector is clear, is just you are just to take the section. Okay, so you can. From Vm, if you evaluate to the R point, what you get is precisely M. Okay. So, okay, so I continue on vector group scheme. I don't know why. Sorry. Okay, and so a very special case, but which is a main case of interest for us, is when M is locally free of finite rank. So in that case, we can consider the dual, and the dual is also locally free of finite rank. And then the R algebra, okay, the symmetric algebra is of finite presentation. Okay, so the reference here are in the, well, this is a quotendic de Donné. And then what happened is that the functor, which is more natural to think about in as first glance, namely to take the M tensor RS, is representable by the affine R scheme V of the M dual. Okay. And another notation for this guy is WM. Okay. So of course you can ask about representation of WM about this functor here for an arbitrary M. But it turns out that the finite locally freeness assumption is a necessary condition for representability. And this thing, I trusted it in a lecture by Romagny. I did not trace it anywhere else. So if somebody knows another reference, I will be interested in that. Okay, so this is not in the basic reference for sure. Okay. Well, so vector bundle, so this is a definition of which is in the Gers-Wedern, okay, which is perfectly good. So a vector bundle of R can be zero, huh? Be careful, over spec R, the affine scheme spec R is an affine R scheme X, such that you can find a partition of the unity, so one is F1 plus Fn, and isomorphism of the localization. So when you take you localize X to RFI, what you get is just V over RFI power R, so namely the affine space of dimension R. Okay, and we want one more condition. This is not enough. Okay, we want that the Karst maps. Okay, so what happened when you take phi I minus I phi minus one phi g, and we want this map to be linear automorphism. Okay, else if you remove this second condition, what you get this is a so-called in geometry they call it the theory of affine varieties. Okay, in Riemannian geometry, for example. Okay, so do not forget the second condition. So I will be more precise later about what I call a linear automorphism. Okay, but this is an automorphism which is induced by a linear map between these two models. Okay. So. So this is, sorry, I go to. And so what is the Swan-Serre's correspondence? So this is the above functor, so I mean the functor I had before. When you restrict it to the locally free R module, so it induces an equivalence of categories between the locally free R modules of rank R and the vector bundles. But you have to be careful. In a category, the important things are morphism. Okay, so this Swan-Serre's correspondence, we really look about the groupoid. So, namely, we want all automorphism to be isomorphism. Okay. So this is very easy about from the other theorem to deduce that. Okay, it's just to check that essentially that everything is well defined. Okay, so it's done more properly in the group. Okay, so let me give examples of vector bundles. So the most maybe the most important vector bundle, this is the tangent space. So what is the tangent space? So we are given a smooth map of affine schemes. Okay, so I'm not going to define what is a smooth map, but okay, but if you don't know, this is something which is, for example, which is flat, and so that all fiber are smooth in the sense of algebraic variety over a field. Okay, and what is the tangent bundle? This is the preceding construction attached to the cotangent things. Okay, so this is V of omega 1 S over L. So the reason why we need smooth, that is, we want this thing to be a vector bundle. Else, it has no reason to be a vector bundle. And this is, be careful, this is a vector bundle over spec S, over X. Okay. And then a very important case in the history, this is the case of the tangent bundle of the real sphere. So what is the real sphere? This is when you take the ring over the field of Fermi number. So here I need my pen because something is missing. We have to put minus one, okay? So this is an example. So the tangent bundle is an example of vector bundle of dimension two, because this is dimension two, but it is not trivial. But the fact is not trivial, it's actually hard to establish, okay? So you can prove it by using some differential geometry, because all these notions have their counterpart in the differential geometry setting. And what happens, this is the so-called this Eribol theorem, so maybe you have done that, so which is a stronger statement, okay? Which tell you that there is no way to on the sphere. So I'm not good to the for the. There is no way to put a non a vector field which does not vanish anyway. Okay, so it has if you have a vector field, so namely you attach in a continuous way a tangent vector to each point. Okay, it has to vanish somewhere. Okay. And a consequence of that statement is deep actually. Yeah? One is that you cannot equip the real sphere with a Lie group structure. Okay, so we have S1, you have for S3. Yes,
I have. This is my own question. Sorry. So interrupt. Is there any understanding of for which fields K is the sphere, same construction, also give you the tangent bundle with the non-trivial tangent bundle?
Okay, so that's the first question, and I'm not sure of myself, so I will answer it for tomorrow. Okay, so for which field it works? Because I caught this number 38. I can't tell you what it did. This is Robert Swan's paper. I caught it, but I did not read it. Okay. So in this paper, this is there is an algebraic proof of this result. Okay, without using any differential geometry or measure theory, whatever. Okay, and I don't know for which field this is true, but I can answer that for tomorrow. Okay.
Okay.
That's a good question. Okay. But maybe someone in the audience know. I don't know. No. Well, okay. Okay. So I come to linear group. So to precise this, the idea of linearity. So we take M, a locally free R-module of finite rank, and we can tensorize with this dual. And what you get, as you know, this is the endomorphism ring of M. And this endomorphism ring is also locally free R model of finite rank. So this over S has to be has nothing to do here. Okay, so we can consider the vector R group scheme attached with this endomorphism ring. And actually, but this is it has an extra structure because now it's an R functor in associative and unital algebras. And on the other hand, we can consider the automorphism group of M functor. So, namely, each for each ring S over R, we look at this automorphism. So, and under the condition which is above, okay, it's representable by an open R subscheme of W of this one, okay, which is a nice object, and it is denoted by GLM or GL1 of N. It depends on the authors. Okay, so here you have to pay attention a bit with left and right. Okay, so that's the problem of this topic, yeah, because we have this kind, this equivalence of category. So we bear in mind that this group scheme GLM on WM ask on the right here and ask on the on here on the ask on the left on WM and on the right on VM. And by the way, so there is a result by Nitzur. So, which is in the note, if Rn noetherian, okay, so M locally free of finite rank is equivalent to say that this GLM is representable, okay? So once again, if you want to deal with linear groups, we need to put strong assumption on the module you work with, okay? Well, so we have linear groups, and of course so this is the same story, but you can, the most famous one, okay, is when we take the free guy, okay, the R power R, and this is we denote it by GL. Sorry. Okay, no. Okay, so Nitzur, I wrote it on the next page. Okay, bon. And there is an other related construction, slightly more general. So if you are given B locally free OS algebra of finite rank, okay, you can look at the functor of invertible elements. Okay, and similarly, this is representable by an affine group scheme. Okay, so for example, this thing is useful if you take an Étale algebra, something like that. Okay, okay. So this is a linear group we will face today and tomorrow. Okay, so now I come to the co-cycle description of vector bundles, and which is totally similar with what you find in any differential geometry book. Okay, so you are given a locally free R module of rank R, and since it's locally free, you can find a partition of unity and isomorphism between the free guy, okay, and the given module. So my convention is to take trivialization maps from the split object, so the most common object, to the non-standard one. Okay, so you, of course you can reverse that convention, and some people do. Okay, so don't be afraid if you open a book that the convention are not what I do here, or the convention you can find in other books. So that okay, and then what you do, you once you have a trivialization, you look at the transition function. Okay, so you look at phi I minus one phi g, so it will go from this one, okay, because the R F E F G, this is in term of algebraic geometry, this is the intersection of R F I and R F G, okay, and so this is linear. And so, and then that's defined an element of the linear group with these things. And what I mean by linear, okay, so we have this compatibility, okay, so and this is by acting on the left, and another way to say the same thing is that we see this module as column vectors, okay, and it turns out that this function, GEG, yes, is a one co-cycles. So what happens is that if you take three, okay, so E, J, K, you have a compatibility, okay, which is done exactly to have the that way. So G, 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 K, this is G, K over the intersection of the triple intersection. And this is very easy to show, okay? So it's what we call a co-cycle. Sorry. And how we prove it? And we just write the proof is we just write the one in one line proof is you decompose it, okay? And then you have to be careful with the left and the right, but if you are careful, you get the right formula. And when you take trivialization, we have to see what happens if I change the trivialization. But for a vector bundles, I have no much choice. Okay, so the only other trivialization I can take are of this shape. So phi prime I has to be phi I composite with some gi. So here this is not g, this is glr. Sorry. Here this is. And what happened is if you change like that, you get a new another co-cycle, okay, which has this shape, okay, and we say that these two co-cycles are homologous, okay. So a very important thing which already occur at this level, this is when you have two co-cycles which are homologous, there is no way to choose a better, to choose a canonical or even a nice GI, okay? So the fact that you have some freedom here when dealing with homologous co-cycle, this is the reason which makes the one reason making the theory subtle, okay? So this is the definition. So I have problem with my mouse. If we look at this affine cover, so we can abstract the things by denoting Z1 of UR GLR the sign of one co-cycles, okay. And we model by this when we denote by H1, okay, when we model this set of one co-cycles, but model the cohomological relation, So this thing is called a Cech non-abelian, a first example of Cech non-abelian cohomology set. So be careful, this is just a set, a point on set, because you have the element one, which is a class of the trivial element, which is a trivial co-cycle. But there is no way to multiply elements, okay? And so this is this set of cohomology of Cech cohomology. So it's written again, and then if we summarize our construction, so if you have a vector bundle Vm or M, that's the same thing. We have a class gamma M in this cohomology set, And what happened is that by Zariski-Lehing, if we have a co-cycle G and G, we can attach to it a vector bundle VG over R, equipped with trivialization like that, just which satisfies these things. Okay, so we can go backwards. The reason is just algebraic geometry, by definition, allows Zariski-Lehing. Okay, and so we have two maps, and if you look at these two maps, what they do, what you get at the end of the day is that the punctant set classifies the isomorphism classes of vector bundle of rank R over spec R, which are trivialized by this cover. Okay, so this is this correspondence between co-cycles and vector bundles, and I prefer always to work at finite level with a given cover, but of course. There is one thing we can do always is to pass to the limit. We can pass the limit the, of this to pass to the limit of this construction by taking all covers, okay? Because if you have two covers, right, you can intersect all pieces and make a nice refinement of the two covers you have, and then you have transition maps and everything goes nicely, and then we can define so the Cech-Zariski cohomology of R GLR, okay, by this limit, and by passage to the limit, a formal thing that this inductive limit classifies the isomorphism classes of vector bundle of rank R over Speckle. Okay, so what we have done, so we have a geometric object, so vector bundles, and if we just look at isomorphism classes, okay, not the category of Zeus, but the isomorphic classes, you can describe that just by some coordinate things, which is this H1. And I will say this is quite efficient. I will say for tomorrow for curves. Okay. So I'm interested in functoriality. So I have functoriality for rings, okay, and for covers, but I have also functorialities by playing on the groups, and those are very important. So what I mean is that if you have a map of algebraic groups of a group scheme from GLR to GLS, okay, then when you look at these cocycle things, it means that we can attach to a vector bundle VG, where G is some cocycle of rank R, we can attach to it the vector bundle V of FG. And you just take the image by F of your cocycle. Okay, so what I'm doing here, it's a bit tedious, okay? We could try to think in an intrinsical way, okay? So that's possible, but I prefer to stay elementary, okay? And, well, but you can believe me that this construction, so there is natural functor from X to so F lower star of X from vector bundle of rank R to the two vector, not from, but two vector bundle of rank S. Okay, and so let me give example and actually this thing is also true for many other groups. Okay, so when you have a nice constructions, often there is some underlying morphism of group scheme or morphism of groups. Okay. So example of that. So the first one is totally elementary. So this is a direct sum thing. Okay, so you decompose R as sum of two integers, and you take the block map from GLR1 times GLR2 to GLR. Okay. But then actually, so what happened? What you get is just the direct sum of vector bundle. Okay, so this is not very surprising. Okay, and of course you can generalize that with by decomposing more, and an interesting case is when you take one R times, and then you have GM power R. So in term of the theory of group schemes, this is a so-called maximal torus. Okay, and actually, so what happened is that if you have a vector bundle, so since so namely a cocycle in GLR, which can be arranged in such a way it comes from this thing, this is this notion of decomposable vector bundles, so which are direct sum of rank one vector bundles. And as you know, and I think we will do that, we'll see that with Matthew Moreau, the decomposable vector bundles are very important, okay? And in terms of group scheme, it is really about this torus inside GLR. So a more complicated construction, this is a tensor product. So here we decompose R in the product, okay? And when you do that, so this is a Kronecker product of matrix, and this is the vector, what you get is a vector product for vector bundle. Okay, and the last example, which is the most important for us today, this is a determinant. Okay, so you have the map from GLR to GM, which is the determinant. So it makes sense for this reason to take about the determinant of a vector bundle. Of course, you can construct it by cars locally, but in my eyes, this is really the determinant of a vector bundle. This is an avatar, and it's a consequence of the determinant map from GLN to GM. Okay. Well, so almost what everything today is quite general. So I want to say, I mean, specific things, and specific things can be said for AZ rings. Okay, so after a field, the easiest case of to deal with of rings, and so of course this is DVR or the Dedekind ring. Okay. So DVR is not very interesting for what we do here because on a DVR and actually over every local ring, a finite locally free model is free. Okay, so the first interesting example arises with the Dedekind rings. So I think you know what is a Dedekind ring. So this is a Noetherian domain, suggests the localization of at each maximal ideal is a discrete violation ring. Okay, so for example, ring of integers. Rings of function of affine smooth curves are the Dedekind rings. And so a theorem you can find in any book of algebra is the following. So that we know that a locally free air model of positive rank over a Dedekind ring is the sum of a free object plus an invertible air model. So I mean an air model, a projective air model of rank one. And actually, this I is unique up to isomorphism. Okay, so there is we have a very good classification. And for example, for Z, since Z is principal, that a consequence of this theorem is that projective module of finite one over Z are all free. Okay, but my interest today is to see this theorem in geometric way using this theory of co-cycle and so on. Okay, the theory of bundles. And and actually this I did not say that, but this I is the determinant. Okay. And then if you see this is a determinant, it tells you that its isomorphism class is unique. Okay. And and I'm interested in the corollary. And so corollary of that, okay. A corollary of the statement is that if you have a locally free air model whose determinant is trivial, then it is trivial. Okay. And this statement I will try to show you in my own way. Okay. Not using. Okay. Okay, so let me sketch a proof of that. Okay, so how we can prove that? And so this is not mine. Huh? Okay, so this is a harder viewpoint on the topic. I will do. Here this is better. Okay, so we are given a vector bundle Vm. Later we will assume that M is of determinant one. So it travels over an open affine subset. Okay, but we just pick one F. spec FF, and we look at the complement, okay? So the complement, I denote it by sigma, and this is spec R minus spec RF. So what I get are maximal IDs, the PGs, okay? And there are finitely many of them. And what I can do, I can complete, so there are DVR, so I can complete. And I can consider the fraction field of the completion, which is nothing but the tensor product of the fraction field big capital K by the completion of the field. Okay, so I already stated it. This is Nakayama lemma. So over local ring, every projective module of finite quantity is free. Okay, so we can pick a trivialization. So here, be careful. I take the trivialization at the level of the completion. Of course, it exists already at the level without completion. But I want really to specify that with the completion. And then I take a specialization. I take this phi f, a trivialization over this RF, and as before. Okay, I look on the intersection. Okay, so intersection being the tensor, I mean, some of the intersections being the I look at what happened on this completion. Okay, and on this completion, what I get some element GI with entry in the completed field. And as before, I have to take in account choices because I have. Here I have some choice at the level of phi, okay, which is reflected here, okay, and I have also a choice at the level of here and with this choice, okay. But if I take into account the choice, what I get is a well-defined element, okay, in this double coset, okay. So you take the product of the completions of the GLR of the completion modulo the GLR of the integer, and you mod out by the GLR of this RF. Okay, so this is this kind of set you can see, for example, when dealing with Shimura varieties. Okay, and the point is that this map is injective. Okay, so this is a variant that the cocycle determines the vector bundle. Okay. And so I have no time to prove it. So it's done in the note. Okay, it's not hard. Okay, but this is true. And then I assume now that the determinant of VM is trivial. And then to show here what happened is that I have functoriality. So if my determinant bundle is trivial, it means that the class of my GI in this C sigma belongs to the kernel of this determinant, okay? Kernel in the sense of potences, is go to 1A. But I had some choice, okay? So up to Schlange, a bit the trivialization, I can assume that my GI, okay? So that my co-cycles in that sense belongs to SLN. Yes, but SLN is a group which is nicer than GLN for at least one thing, okay? Is that is generated when I take it over a field, is generated by elementary matrices. Okay. So that I'm sure you know that. And then I can use an argument of strong approximation. So this RF here is dense in this product. Okay. So weak approximation is just a capital K is dense, but here we have something stronger. We have this RF to be dense here. Okay. But in the other hand, okay, so and then. By decomposing elements here in a product of elementary matrices, I see that this group SLRF is dense in this product. Okay. But on the other hand, when I look at SLN, this is an open, and actually it's closed in the center, but it's open in SLR here for the topology of this complete field. Okay, so things about SLN of ZP, this is open in SLN of QP, okay? Yes, but if you have a, you know, dance plus open, it makes, this is everything. So what happened is that if you look at this C sigma SLR, this is one, okay? And then my GI has to be trivial, and then it is trivial in GL, okay? So it's if I summarize, it's by a kind of stronger approximation argument, okay, involving these completions, I can show a part of my statement. And actually, with some more effort, you can prove the statement with GLA, okay, with the same method. It required only some more work, okay? And we will see this method again tomorrow because this is very efficient, okay? I took it in an Arbor, maybe it was known else before. Okay.
Philippe, are you still there? Did we lose you? Yep. We've got a problem. Let's see, what do I do? Okay. Lost. The Zoom is still working, so I'll quickly send Philippe a message to let him know that we're no longer seeing him. Anybody know any good stories? Yeah, well, sometimes the magic works, sometimes it doesn't. So I've sent him an email, and there's not much else we can do, I think. Anybody have any questions so far to discuss?
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Sure.
So in differential geometry, to define the Czech cohomology, we usually don't need to go to the direct limit, but we can choose a fine cover,
yes,
a good cover. So in algebraic geometry, do we have the similar thing?
In general, no. I mean, you can have schemes where each affine has, so you'd like to know that your affine pieces, say those are the small pieces, right? They'd satisfy this condition if the isomorphism classes of vector bundles, or even let's say line bundles, would be trivial on each of the overlaps, on each of the affine pieces, right? That's what you'd need for the covering. But that's often not the case. You have schemes with very large sets of isomorphism classes of even line bundles. Like if you take even an elliptic curve over the complex numbers, you can't find one open cover that will trivialize every line bundle, just because there are uncountably many Right, the open covers, you can only remove finitely many points from the elliptic curve. That's a Zariski open cover, but there are uncountably many different line bundles. If you're talking about cohomology of coherent sheaves, that's a different story because those are trivialized on affine open subsets. Yeah. And if you have a separated scheme, then you can always achieve that by just taking any affine cover. Mm-hmm. But for these other types of cohomology, then unless you have some finite generation properties, which you often don't have. Mm-hmm. So that's a good question.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments while we kill time here?
Is there some way to fix this problem you just mentioned by moving to a different topology?
Could you repeat that? I couldn't.
This problem that you just mentioned by moving to a different topology. So instead of working in the Zariski topology, maybe you can work in.
Yeah. But then the co-cycle may not compute the isomorphism classes because. Mm-hmm. Well. Yeah, I mean, it depends on the topology. It turns out for vector bundles, you can actually, Hilbert theorem 90 says you can also use the et al. Topology, but you still have the same problem.
Right.
You won't be able to trivialize every vector bundle on a fixed finite cover.
I have a quick question. How much simpler is it to compute the determinant like that Professor Gilles is talking about? Like, does it simplify?
Oh, it's a lot simpler. I mean, I think so, because the group you're dealing with is just the multiplicative group of units. It's a commutative group. So, I mean, it's easier to deal with multiplication of numbers than it is to deal with multiplication of matrices. And so I think it's easier. I mean, for example, the set of isomorphism classes of line bundles, I think somebody mentioned this in the chat, forms a group. And so you can try and understand the set by its group structure. And I mean, there's classical theorems about smooth projective varieties over an algebraically closed field that the group structure is given by a torus, you know, an abelian group variety times some finitely generated abelian group. So you can get a pretty good idea of the structure, but if you take the set of isomorphism classes of vector bundles, that can be a very strange object. There's you have this whole which is something I'm not so familiar about, but moduli spaces of vector bundles. It can be quite mysterious, especially some moduli spaces of vector bundles become even non-separated as schemes. So they're not going to be group varieties, and they can be quite mysterious in terms of their structure. Or let's say more mysterious than the case of line bundles. But there are certainly other people in the audience who know more about moduli of vector bundles. Up, do we get?
Yes, I'm back.
Okay.
I'm sorry. It's a problem of connection here where I am. I had to restart the system, but okay.
That's so. What old stories while you're away. So
okay, so certainly. Yeah, okay. So okay. Let me share the screen once again. Okay. I'm okay. So the good thing, the interruption was when I was changing of chapter. Okay, so this is the second chapter. So why is the Zariski topology not fine enough? So the one argument, I will give two arguments. One is with quadratic bundles. Okay, so quadratic bundles in algebraic geometry, we see them in terms of quadratic forms. So what is a quadratic form for us. Okay, so this is R model M with a map which is quadratic and Q from M of R. So the first condition is quadratic, and the associated we want is that this form BQXY, okay, which is defined as it's written, we want it to be symmetric and bilinear. Okay, and as it is written, is not clear, but this is tabbed by this definition is tabbed by base change. Okay, so and the form Q is said regular if this BQ induce an isomorphism between M and is dual. Okay, and a fundamental example, this is a hyperbolic form attached to a locally free R module of finite form. Okay, bon. So here this is just a partial viewpoint on the topic, okay, which essentially is the viewpoint of a form of even rungs. Okay, but that's enough for our consideration of today. And then we consider a regular quadratic form MQ where R, M is locally free of rank R. And it's tempting to make analogy with the vector bundles. Okay, so you can say a quadratic bond forms as an with some enrichment of your vector bundle. And then we can consider the orthogonal group scheme OQM. So this is a closed group scheme, closed subgroup scheme of GLM. And for an open cover U of R as before, and we can define similarly co-cycles and also church H1, okay? And actually what I did for this orthogonal group scheme, I can do it for any group scheme, okay? And we do that, and what we get is the following, that this set classifies the isomorphism classes of regular quadratic forms, which are locally isomorphic over E to QM. So this is nice, okay, because that gives you something, but it's not exactly what we want. So what is not what we want? Because regular quadratic form over R of dimension R have no reason to be locally isomorphic to MQ or to any other one, okay? So you can think, for example, just as the case of a field, okay, the field of real numbers, where the regular quadratic form are just classified by signature, okay? And over a field, of course, Zariski locally speaking, there is nothing interesting, okay? So one single cover, and then the set is this set H1 Zariski is only of piece of what we would like to obtain, and what we like to obtain is a set of H1 which really classify isomorphism classes of regular quadratic forms. Okay, so this is one thing. Okay, so for quadratic for the quadratic form things, this H1 is not very sweet. And also the other important thing, so this is, yes, more Grothendieck, I will say, this viewpoint, this is what happened with this change of groups operation. Okay, so when we have a map of GH of group schemes, we would like to understand to have some control, and this is vague, about on the map H1 from G to H1 from H. So to say things about image, about the kernel, about fibers, okay? And when you start to investigate this problem, you face difficulties. So let me take an important example, which is a Kummer map. So what is a Kummer map? You take GM, this is GL1, and you take the map which goes from T to T power D for an integer D. So H1 of GM, as we have seen, we can call it also the Picard group that classifies invertible modules, so locally free modules of rank one. And this map, if you think from peak R to peak R, So this map FD lower star at lower star, this is the map which take a invertible module to m times this tensor product d times. And so what can we say about this map? So about the image, I don't know, maybe Frederick or somebody will talk about that. So it will involve higher etal cohomology. So right now I'm just saying about the kernel, okay? And so the kernel, it has a concrete description. So we take an element M, so namely an invertible model, so with the trivialization of its d power, okay? And then the natural things to do is to introduce the commutative group ADR, so this is my notation, this is not of isomorphism classes of couple M theta, where M is an invertible R model, and theta is a trivialization of its d power. Okay, so of course you can multiply elements like that, and this is a group because you can take M dual and so on. Okay, and then when you do that, so from this AD of R to pick R, you have a forgettable map just by forgetting theta. You just keep the invertible model, and then what I claim is that we have an exact sequence like that. Okay, so ADR maps onto this kernel. So of course it was tailor-made to do it, but the interesting thing is about this kernel. Okay, and what is this kernel? This is actually it's covered by R star mod R star power d. And the explicit map is you take R, so this is a trivial R module, but the trivialization is not trivial. This is the map. We take an element X. No, I'm sorry. No, my map is not, this is not the right map. Sorry, I have to take. Sorry, this is not A, this is theta A, and here I think I take it's not XD, it's just AX. Yes, sorry. I have to change that on my notes. And then you can check that. And for those aware of etal cohomology, this thing can be explained by etal cohomology. Okay, but not at the Zariski level. Okay, so this ADR and has no I do not see a way to interpret it in a cohomological way with what we have done. Okay. And then this is an example, but of course there are others. So quotentic set ID is to extend the notion of cover in algebraic geometry. Okay. So they did it originally with etal covers, but it turns out that flat covers setting is simpler in a first approach. Okay, for what we do. Okay. So and actually this is what is done in De Masure-Gabriel or Ignus. And so what is a flat cover? In French, this is called FPPF, fidèlement plat de présentation fini. So it's a finite collection of L rings satisfying two properties. So first, we ask SI to be flat of finite presentation. Okay. And secondly, we want that speaker is the union of the image of the spec SI, of the image of the spec SI. Okay, we want it to be surjective. As topological space. So the second notion is natural. The first one maybe a bit less for you. Okay. But so an important thing is that if you have such a cover like that, you can take the product, okay, and the product will satisfy the things too. So the condition one and two can rephrase by saying that S is faithfully flat air algebra or finite presentation. So in practice, if we want, and it is simpler to deal like that, okay, we can always deal with a unique ring. Okay, so we have a finite collection, but actually one ring is enough to make the whole theory. So what you should first notice is that this theory generalizes the other one, what we have done before. Okay, so if you take a partition of unity, okay, but then this ring, this collection of rings is a flat cover of R, and so is the product. Okay. And so here is called a Zariski cover, and what I'm saying is that the Zariski cover is a flat cover too. Okay. Bon. So what is Shesh-Navnabeyan cohomology? So as I said, I deal only with a single faithfully flat air algebra S. And then I have maps, okay? So I write them in terms of rings. Of course, you can dualize and write in terms of spectrum. So we have projections, and projection to 2 and to 3, okay? And also other projection from 2 to 3, okay? Bon. So, and there are formulas relating all those maps. But I do not write them because I'm not giving any proof here. So I'm given an air group scheme, for example, GLN or Togal group, whatever. Okay. And what is the cocycle from G and SR? So this is an element of G of this tensor product S tensor R by S, which satisfies this rule, which is, so this rule is with the 3. Okay. Here is the 2. And we ask, Q1 to G, Q2 to 3G to be like that. And we denote by Z1, so this is the set of one co-cycles. Let me say, and maybe this is later written, I forgot, but in the case of Zariski cover, this is exactly the same definition that what we have done before. Okay, so this is a generalization. And two such co-cycles are set homologous if there is some H in JS such that G can be written like that. G is P1 star H minus 1, G prime, P2 star H. Okay, and similarly as before, we can denote by H1 as that SRG, the pointer set of one cocycle up to cohomology equivalence. Okay. Bon, so this is just definition. And bon, so this is what I said before. So, and here there is a subtle point that the fact we can pass on the limit on all flat covers. Okay, so here this is important to use this finite presentation 6. Okay, so there are more details on the note about that. Okay, because of course if you have two flat covers, so two rings I had before, you can take the tensor product, but you have to be a bit careful with a set theory of doing limits. Okay, but this is done properly in De Bazio-Gabriel. Okay, so and so the good news is that all my construction is functorial in R and also in the group scheme. Okay, as before, I can allow morphism of group scheme. And now I come to torsors. So a right G torsor X is an R scheme equipped with a right action. So be careful, the right action, that's what we mentioned, which satisfies the following properties. So first, the action map, so which is take XG to XXG is an isomorphism. And secondly, there exists a flat cover R prime of R such that X R prime is not empty. Okay. So if you, so I will comment about these two axioms. So the first axiom is always present. The second axiom, there are variants of it which are equivalent depending of your reference. So the first condition reflects the simple transitivity of the action. So what means simply transitivity in that context is means that GT for T an air scheme, an air ring, acts simply transitively on XT. Okay. So of course, if XT is empty, this is simply transitive. The action is simply transitive. Okay. So and the second condition is the local triviality condition. Okay. So an example, so for example, if I take the empty scheme, is going to be to satisfy the first property. Okay. So if you want to check that something is a torsor, you have to check both. Okay. And an example of torsors, the most common torsors is called split torsors. You take X to be G and G acting by right translation. Okay, so this is the simplest example of torsor, but it's really important. Okay. So I recall the axiom for torsors. And an important thing is that we know when a torsor is isomorphic to the split torsor. It's when it has a point, because if you have a point, so if X here is not empty, a point X defines a morphism G to X, which takes G to XG, so just orbit, and this thing has it must be an isomorphism by the simple transitivity property, and then in that case we say that X is trivial, so namely it's isomorphic to the split torsor. And one other way to rephrase the condition two, taking into account what I've said, is that two says that air torsor X under G is locally trivial for the flat topology. So maybe it's not trivial locally for Zariski. Okay, so it's too much to ask. But if I allow flat base change, it becomes trivial. Okay, so and no, I can be more precise about morphism. So it's just a G equivariant map, and once again, by the simple transitivity property, any such a map has to be an isomorphism. So what I mean is that the category of G torsors is a groupoid. Okay, so this is a very nice category. Good. And so what is the relation with cocycle? So is that the relation cocycle comes from the following fact, that the air functor of orthomorphism of the trivial G torsor G is represented by G by acting by left translation. Okay, because once you know where one goes, okay, then it's defined. So this is very rigid. Okay, so any morphism of this trivial torsor is just defined with a value of your transformation at one, and then that's the reason why the only morphism are the left translation. Okay. So now I take a formal definition. This H1 is a, so here I know IP, FPPF, that's a set of isomorphism class of G torsor for the flat topology, okay? And I can look at a smaller subset, okay? For each S, I can look at things, at classes which are split, so which are split by or trivialized by S, okay? Well, and then, as in the vector bundle case, we shall construct a class map, okay, coming from the torsors, okay, to the cocycles, to the set of cocycles. Well, so I'm already late, so I will go fast on that, okay. But this is always the same ideas, okay. You take a trivialization, you compare them, okay. And the comparison gives you a cocycle, and this cocycle depends on choice, but the choice are up to cohomologous cocycle, and then it works well. Okay. Well, sorry to go too fast, but you at this point. Okay. So and once again, what you get, this is formal. When you do this kind of computation, what you get are co-cycles. But this class map here is well defined. The problem is to study this map, and here comes the technicalities. Okay, so so his study involves the technicality, which is called the faithfully flat descent theorem of Grothendieck. Okay, so here I need this technical fact, which is this interlude. So I hope that you have already seen that in your mathematical life. So that's a beautiful and amazing result. Okay, so. So this result holds without any condition of finitely presented. That's the reason why I changed the letter. So I take T to be a faithfully flat extension of the ring R. And I look at tensor product of T D times with itself. And the first term of this theory, this is so-called the Amitsur complex. Okay, so which is a map. So I will write the differential. So we have a complex from M to M tensor T, M tensor T, like that. And the differentials are defined. Okay, so this is a complex. But if T is faithfully flat, the first result is that this complex is exact. Okay. And so this is important for several reasons. But one is that for any affine air scheme X, okay, XR, I can identify XR with element of XT such that P1 upper star X is P1 upper star in here. Okay. So these things tell you that you are not losing any information to go from R to T once if you control the what happened here. Okay. So this is a consequence. So this is clear because if X is affine, so X is spec R. Okay, I'm looking a map from A to T, and if a map, if I take a map from A to T, but is a map such that this to define a map like that is to define a map here which goes to zero. Okay, so this is a conflict. And actually, well, this is true for any scheme, not necessarily affine. Okay. Well, okay. So what is faithfully flat descent? So here one T is missing on the left. Okay, so we given a T module, we consider the T tensor T module P1 star N. So this is N P2. Okay, sorry for. So here this is P2. And we are interested in diagram like that. So an isomorphism phi. So descent data, this is an isomorphism like that. Okay, such that we have a compatibility, okay, with phi 3, phi 2, phi 1, where phi 3, phi 2, phi 1 are deduced by phi by this formula. Okay, well, of course, it has to be read, and you can learn that in 1 minute. Okay, but the interesting thing is that. So here I have still problem with my. Sorry. So there is a clear notion of morphism for T modules equipped with the descent data. Okay. And And if M is an R module, so the identity of M gives rise to a canonical isomorphism between this P1 M tensor T and with P2. Okay, and this thing we can check. It's a bit, of course, tedious, but we can check this is a descent data. And the theorem is the following. This Rotendick Fesselschlager descent theorem, that this functor from M, which associated to M with this canonical descent data, is an equivalence of categories between category of R module and that of T module with descent data. Okay, and then, so namely, like for you are not losing any information, but instead to consider M, you consider this gadget. And the way to go back is we have n phi, so n is a T module with a descent data, and you look and you have a precise formula in terms of tensors which define R module. So this thing is R module, and also when you tensorize this R module to T, you get the original n. So this is the first statement, and the second part of the statement is that you can, it's so nice. Okay, so you can also play with R algebras here. Okay, so the above functor, you induce an equivalence of categories between category of R algebras and T algebras with descent data. Okay, so this is this gadget and this theorem, this is permits to do the same gluing things that you do usually for Zariski topology for these flat things, okay? And here, this is about affine, and if it's not affine, there are extra difficulties and extra certain things I don't want to talk right now, okay? So this theorem is one good reason to concentrate on the affine setting. So let me go back to the vector bundle. So remember Swan-Sears correspondence, okay, between projective modules and vector bundles. Actually, we can add one more categories, okay? So if a consequence of a Fesselschlager descent theorem and also the fact that the property to be locally free is so-called local for étale topology. So I mean, a module is finite locally free of rank R if only if it is after some flat base change, Fesselschlager flat base change. So a consequence of this result is the following theorem. Okay. So let M be a locally free R module of rank R, then the R functor, which go from S to isom to SR M tensor RS, is representable by a Gilliar torsor. Okay. And so this isom construction permits to associate to any locally free R module of rank R a GLR torsor. And then when you write the things in a categorical words, what you get is that this functor M to XM induces an equivalence of categories between the group point of locally free R modules of rank R and the category of GLR torsors. Okay, so this one there is even rich, correspondence is even richer. Okay. Yes, but you could say there is nothing new, because what is true is that GLR torsors and locally free R modules are free after some Zariski localization. This is true, but actually, just to say this sentence. Give us very important corollaries. Okay, so the important corollaries is this Hilbert Grothendieck 90 theorem. Okay, which reflects that GLR torsors are the same with flat topology or with Zariski topology. And then the precise statement is that. H1 Zariski R GLR is H1 FPPF R GLR. Okay? And so in particular, if you take a local ring, sorry. If you take a local ring, H1 FPF R GLR or local ring or even semi-local, this is one. Okay. Bon, so this is not the more general statement. The more general statement is GL with a separable algebra. Okay. So for example, an Zeeman algebra. But for today, this is already very nice to have that. Okay. Bon, of course, I did not prove the Fesfodi flat descent theorem, but this is a straightforward consequence of it. Okay. So I realize that I'm out of time, but let me just continue. Mark, I have 5 minutes because of the interruption.
Certainly.
Okay. Well, anyway, if I do not finish all my things tomorrow, this is not a problem. The most important thing are the foundation in mathematics, as you know. Huh? So, not the roof. Okay. So. Well, so I'm come back to my initial perspective, which was to compare the H1 here with torsor and H1 with cocycle. Well, so the first statement, which is totally general, that this map is injective. Okay, so I will not prove it, but this is a consequence of Fesfodi flat descent. If you, for example, and the hard part. Well, okay, no. I proved it, but I have no time to prove it. Okay, so we can see the notes, the proof. The half part is the surjectivity. Okay, so namely, if G is affine, so here, the reason why I put affine is because I need the Fesfodi flat descent theorem. The class map is an isomorphism. So it means that we have exactly what we want, namely torsors and cocycles up to equivalence are really the same things up to isomorphism. Okay, and then let me explain why we can go from the right to the left. So namely, having a cocycles. We can construct a torsor. Okay, so this is okay. So I sketch a proof of the theorem. So we are given a cocycle, okay, and so G is affine. And then since G is affine, I have the left translation by G, and when I look at the level of function, it takes a star up. Okay, so I get a map like that, and then I want to use the Fesfodi flat descent theorem. I want to define an identification function phi g, and phi g has to go from S tensor Sg to Sg tensor R over S, and from this Lg star, so there is a natural way to construct some phi g like that, is to take here alpha and beta. Okay, and which are natural function here, so natural isomorphism, and to verify G like that. Okay, so here you have to believe me that this phi G defines a descent data. Okay, so this is the next step. So the cocycle condition, because we have a condition on this G, when you write it at the level of this phi G, this is exactly the condition to be a descent data for this S algebra. Yes, but the descent theorem defines an R algebra Rx, okay? And then by functoriality, you can check that this X comes with the left action of G. And when you extend to S back, you see this is a torsor. But then it is a torsor, it has to be a torsor because and to be an isomorphism, this is something which is local after Fesfodi flat base change. Okay, and actually, this algebra defined by this descent method, okay, is a torsor. And if you specify what I have done here just to the Zariski things, you will see what we are doing here will be just Zariski gluing, okay? And then this construction I have done is called twisting, okay? So this is a special case. So I have twisted a torsor, but more generally, I can twist an affine air scheme equipped with a left action of G, okay? So then, I can use G or G lower star this G define a descent data, okay? And then we can twist this Y by this cross-cycle, and what we get is this YG. And the nice thing, of course, it is affine over R, okay? This is functorial, okay? So, and a special case is when you take G acting on itself by an isomorphism, then the GG is called the twisted air group scheme, okay? So, if G is commutative, you get nothing new, but if G is not commutative, you get a new group scheme. Well, actually, I use cocycle for simplicity, but the above construction do not depend of any choice, okay, of cocycle trivialization. So actually, you can vary the thing in an intrinsic way by twisting by a torsor, okay? And that the notation is with like that, Y twisted by E and G twisted by E, okay? So I will use tomorrow a bit these things, okay? And let me just say that in practice, if we ask all the scheme to be affine, this is too strong, okay? So example, we like projective spaces and things like that, which are not affine. So if you want to work with non-affine schemes, so you need more technicalities. Time to time, descent is not possible. But for example, for J scheme equipped with an ample invertible generalized bundle, which is a case of, for example, if you take GLN and projective spaces, then it can be done. Okay, so I use the affine setting for simplicity, but many things can be pushed further. Okay, so tomorrow I will end with the generalities and go to the curves. Okay, which are the main topic. And I hope that I will manage to give some statement which are really relevant for homotopy theory and things like that. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks very much, really. Lovely talk. Are there any questions or comments? Questions?
Maybe I can ask a question. You're talking about Zariski topology is not enough. So is Adela topology enough, or is there, I mean, you use FPPF. So is there a counterexample or choose that the Adela topology is not enough?
Okay. So, Etal topology is good. For example, if you take the Kummer cover, okay? So this T power D.
Yeah.
So if D is invertible in R, this is nice because it is going to be an Etal cover, okay? But if D is not invertible, this is only a flat cover, okay? So what I'm saying is that if we want to extract D roots of your rings, okay, and when D is not invertible, and it happens, then you cannot limit yourself to the flat setting, to the Etal setting for torsors. So but there is one case I did not have the time to set. I will go on that tomorrow quickly. This is it will deal with a smooth group scheme, etal covers are enough. Okay?
Okay, thanks. Yeah, so it's where deal with unramified kind of unramified or unsmooth case. So, okay.
Thanks. But let me just say that the flat theory, at first glance, this is simpler. Etal is a more sophisticated object.
Okay.
And one thing you have with etal, okay, and is that you have a notion of local rings. Maybe you know that. This Encelian construction, okay? So Schroer has a kind of construction like that in the flat setting, but this is very abstract, okay? This is not a ring we can really think about, okay?
Yeah.
So etal has many advantages, but it requires more work, actually. Because smoothness is a more elaborated concept than flatness. I mean, that's just what I'm saying.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so I think we could save further questions for the discussion session. So we'll have a discussion session after the next lecture. And I encourage you to go to that and pose your questions there.